Wrokdown.
Hi, welcome to Wrokdown. I'm Wendy Stapleton. Oh, tonight I'm very excited. This is our very first international guest on Wrokdown, and I hope it's not the last. This man started his songwriting career working for Apple Publishing. Paul McCartney was his boss, and a very nice one, I hear. He wrote hits for Mary Hopkins, Art Garfunkel, Brian Ferry. That's just to name a few. But I think he's probably better known in Australia as the other half of a famous duo called Gallagher and Lyle. And here with us tonight, we have Mr. Benny Gallagher. I think he's going to give us a song.
Inside, outside, I've been around. Love set me up, love let me down again. Feel like a weatherman. One day sun, the next day rain. And you ask me if I really care. Don't you know the answer? Rainy day blues, never felt this way. I wanna stay with you for the rest of my life. I wanna lay with you for the rest of my life. I wanna stay with you for the rest of my life.
So my very special guest this evening is Benny Gallagher. Welcome, Benny.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for giving us your time. As I just said in the intro, you started songwriting at Apple.
Uh-huh.
Apple Publishing?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Writing songs, I think, was to start with for Mary Hopkins?
That's right, yeah.
Was it totally run by the Beatles?
Mm-hmm. Mostly by Paul. The others had the other projects, like the Hare Krishna Orchestra and the Plastic Ono Band and all that. But Paul was the really active one in the studio recording a lot of Apple artists.
I'm actually wondering, how did you actually get your foot in the door to start with?
Again, a total accident. We'd done a publishing deal in London, came down from Scotland, a small town in Scotland where we lived, and silly and young enough to think we'd be songwriters. And it worked. Within the first year, we'd signed a contract, which was rubbish. So by the end of that year, we were out of it. And we bumped into this guy called Terry Doran, who had a big afro haircut and a big Zapata moustache. And he was in this office in Radio Caroline, which the film's out about now.
I'll rock the boat.
And it was just an empty office. He had a tape machine and a desk, and that was it. And he said, oh, this is going to be huge, you know. And we thought, sure. And they said, but can't say, and it's coming out in 2 weeks, going to be a big press launch. And that was Apple, and we turned it down. We thought, we'll pass on this. And God bless Terry. He heard our demos again later, and he still wanted to sign us, so we got in.
That is wonderful. Yeah. So you'd come down from Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
So where did you grow up?
Well, it was a small seaside town. And really, you either joined a band or you ended up in the pub all the time or whatever, and or got yourself in trouble. And we were lucky. We had a local band, and we used to run our own shows, and the Polaris submarines were just across the water from us. So the bands from there would come and play in our shows. And we learned a huge amount about harmonies and the way the Americans played. Then we used to do the American air bases in Scotland to play them too.
Because I also heard someone saying that a huge amount of import records would be brought up to the ports.
That's
because
right.
you couldn't just go into shops and buy American
That's right. Yeah,
cuts.
You could only hear it on things like Radio Luxembourg. It wasn't really been played in the UK at that time. And there's a great story. Graham Lyle, I was just working with him a couple of weeks ago, and He's got a guitar that he's coveted from that those days. It was bought by one of the other guys in Lars who had a band, and he gave an American sailor a kilt for this guitar, which the only other one was seen as Jimmy Page has one.
Yeah. I think he got the better deal.
I think so. Yeah. I don't think the American had the right knees for a kilt.
For a kilt. And they'd probably definitely have to wear something underneath.
Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Was it tough where you came from, or was it
no,
just cold?
A lovely and wet. And wet, very yeah. wet. There's this phrase that where we come from, all the people in the rest of Scotland say, how you know you come from that town as you walk about like this, because of the wind and rain. You know, it's just constantly like this, you know. And it's actually a great wee town, a lovely wee country town with the seaside, and we had a great time there. But as I say, we would have been bored to death if we hadn't been in the band.
For music. Yeah. So do you think that's why so many people actually were great musos in places like that? Is it something that you all can get together and do? Mm-hmm. As you said, you either play or you end up in a lot of
yeah,
trouble.
Yeah, that's right. And our particular circle that we used to play with, there was Lulu, there was the Average White Band, Jerry Rafferty. It was just all these guys were into that sort of music. You know, it was either Black or Black in Harmony or the Everly Brothers, all that. And they all developed their own styles out of that.
See, it was very interesting. I used to wonder why so many bands from Scotland were funky.
Mm.
And I remember, actually, I was in the front row here at Festival Hall to see Average White Band. Mm. And that, quite frankly, was a long time before a lot of other people were coming out here playing funk, because we were only just starting to get imported records as well.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
And I could not for the life of me work out how this Scottish band with a red-headed singer could sound so funky, but it's obviously you all grew up listening to this music.
Exactly right.
Okay, we're going to take a short break, but okay. When we come back, we'll talk about you hitting London,
okay,
starting to work mm-hmm. for Apple Publishing,
mm-hmm.
and then the list of people that you've written for just goes on and on. We'll be back soon.
Wrokdown.
Welcome back to Wrokdown. My special guest this evening is Benny Gallagher. Benny, we were talking about you coming from Scotland
mm-hmm.
down to London at the age of 21
mm-hmm.
with Lyle
mm-hmm.
to become songwriters.
Yeah.
Did it seem pie in the sky, or you must have been quietly confident?
Well, no, we just loved it. We had a local band, as I said earlier, but the thing that really got us was hearing Carole King and Jerry Goffin and Bikrack and David. And we thought, what is this? We want to be part of this more than being in a band even. So that was what we decided we would do. Yeah.
So with the songwriting situation there, was it, say, for example, were you paid a wage? I mean,
yes. Princely sum of £25 a week.
But that would have been okay.
It was a lot of money, yeah, in those days, yeah.
So Paul McCartney wasn't stingy?
No. I'll tell you, the other thing they've done is, just before we came to Australia, they gave us back all of our copyrights, you know, and thanks very much, guys, you know, and they just behaved impeccably.
Well, that is so good to hear. Yes. That is so good to hear. Someone's not greedy.
Yes.
Okay, so you were paid to write.
Mm-hmm.
So would you just sit there, what, 8 hours a day?
Yeah, we made a deliberate thing. I mean, some writers just say, oh, well, I don't feel like it today. But we did it like a 9-to-5 job, because I had two sets of twins by then, so we were really on a borderline of...
Two sets of twins? Yeah. Four?
Yeah.
So not only did you write songs...
It focused us, I'll tell you that.
You were a busy boy, weren't you?
Yeah.
Very busy boy, because I of course, was very familiar with the idea of the Brill Building.
Yes.
And that sounded very much like a very competitive and organised mm-hmm. situation there,
yeah,
because it was just floor after mm-hmm. floor of songwriters.
That's right, yeah.
Did you ever go there?
No, we knew all about it, though, because of our interest in Carole King, and it was such a great idea. Simon Garfunkel were in there too. It was just an amazing collection of writers. But Apple wasn't that competitive way. It was more a thing about, yes, guys, you know, we like what you're doing, we want you to keep doing that and just expand yourself.
The thing is, and as you mm. said, they weren't competitive to actually sell stuff on. Was it more like writing for, say, for example, for Mary?
Yes.
If there was a project on.
Yes.
And who else did they have?
Well, James Taylor was there as well. So it was an amazing collection and quality of and width of music, you know, either in performance or in songwriting.
Now, look, this is probably not very professional, but you have worked with and written for so many people
mm-hmm.
that I'm going to have to pick up my piece of paper here, because look at this. Now, these are the artists that have recorded your songs.
Yes.
We'll just start. We'll do a little bit. Art Garfunkel, Brian Ferry, Colin Blunstone, Don Williams, Donovan, Elkie Brooks, Fairport Convention, Garth Brooks, Jim Capaldi, Joe Brown, Judith Durham, Little Anthony and the Imperials, Mary Hopkins, Phil Everly, Ricky Nelson, Ringo Starr, Rita Coolidge, Simon and Garfunkel, Status Quo, The Furies, and Davey Arthur, and Lemon Jelly, that's to name but a few. It's not bad.
Well, it's amazing. It's almost been by accident. I don't understand it, really. People just hear the songs. We don't actually sell them as such. It's just they pick up on them.
Well, look, when
Brian Ferry, there's a great example.
Brian Ferry?
We were recording Heart on My Sleeve, and he was walking down the corridor to go to the studio he was working in, and heard it, and phoned the publisher and said, I want to do this song. And he didn't even speak to us. He just heard the song and wanted to do it.
Could you give us a little bit of that?
Yeah.
Please. Mm-hmm. I'd be lucky.
I wear my heart on my sleeve. I'm not afraid to say what I mean what I say. I've set myself up, let myself down. I may be a fool to spread it around, but I just want to let you know. Sometimes I find it so hard not to show. So I sigh and I let my feelings go. I wear my heart on my sleeve. 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 Heart on my sleeve.
Oh, how wonderful, how wonderful. You wrote a huge hit for Art Garfunkel.
Well, it was a weird thing. The first thing he recorded was Graham and I had toured with a 22-piece string section. We knew something was not right when we outnumbered the audience at one gig, and we thought, oh. So we were facing almost bankruptcy, and we wrote this whole album, Breakaway. And before we could record Breakaway, he'd heard it and recorded it himself. And so that was our introduction to Art Garfunkel.
Please, a little bit of Breakaway.
Okay, I'll have to reach in here, so.
That's all right. We're watching a very famous songwriter retune.
There we go. Oops.
You can do what you like.
There you go, Anne.
I watch the distant lights go down the runway, disappear into the evening sky. Oh, you know I'm with you on your journey, never could say goodbye. You may waken in another country, greet the morning under foreign skies, leaving me to face another Monday. It's not easy to get by. It's not the place you're going to. It's just the phase you're going through. Though I won't stop you, I don't want you to break away. Fly across your ocean, break away. Time has come for you, break away. Fly across your ocean, break away. Time has come. for you.
Wrokdown.
Welcome back to Wrokdown. I'm with the one and only Mr. Benny Gallagher of Gallagher and Lyle fame. Benny, yourself and Graham didn't actually come out as Gallagher and Lyle to Australia. How did you end up first coming out here?
I actually came as a bass player with the Manfreds, which was Manfred Mann with the two singers, Paul Jones and Mike Dabble.
Okay.
And great band to play in. So we toured all over Europe and the Middle and Far East and eventually got here to Australia as well. Had some really good gigs here.
People do eventually make it
yes,
here.
Yes. Uh-huh.
And I'm so glad you did because I'm not sure, during that tour, you met promoters here.
That's right.
That suggested that you start to come back.
Yes.
One of those promoters, of course, being Sir Walter Bishop the
yes,
Third.
That's right.
OAM.
But Wal was over staying with us last year, and he came to a festival I was at, so he thought he saw me for the first time doing this stuff acoustically rather than with bands, and he thought that'd be a good thing to do. So we've just done Byron Bay, and
how was it?
Lovely. What a great festival. It's like Glastonbury without the cold. It's still wet, but it's warm.
Was it wet?
Yeah.
Was it?
Yeah.
It's a weird thing.
Yeah.
It's been very wet
yeah.
up there. So you're doing a few gigs.
Yeah.
Where have you been? In Victoria in particular?
Well, no.
Because that's where I can go and see.
This is my first gig in Victoria because I've been staying with Wally. But we're planning some more later in the year. So that's the idea, to try and sort of develop it.
So you'll be coming back?
Oh, I'd love to come back.
To visit
it's
us.
Great fun, yeah.
And when you go back, you're going back to Scotland or do you live? No, you live in
no, I live in London.
London.
Yeah. Well, I've just formed a new record label, so
tell us about that.
I'd actually stopped working in the music industry. I was disillusioned with it and became the chairman of a collection society for. I founded it and then became the chairman for 7 years, and it was great. We collected a lot of money for performers.
Can you explain that a little bit? Because
yeah.
I know what it's about,
uh-huh.
but it's basically
yeah.
a bit like our APRA. Is that correct?
Well, no,
or
it's,
not really?
It's even slightly different than that. It's for performers rather than for writers.
Oh, okay,
and,
like PPCA, I think we have.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah, we've got PPL, but
okay.
The right is equitable remuneration, basically. And Britain didn't have the right until 96, and they were the biggest earners in the world, and it was really weird. So we changed all that and renegotiated deals with Japan and everything. And we ended up paying about $20 million to British performers in the time I was there. It's far more now, but it started, and it's now those performers' pensions. So every time you guys play something on the TV or the radio, that performer will get a piece of
it. A piece of it.
Yeah. And it's wonderful to see. I used to love writing out the checks.
You know, do you still do it? I've
retired from that now, but there's still an ongoing thing. There's a thing in Europe at the moment for more copyright protection, so I'm involved a wee bit now on the side. And, yeah.
So then you've started your own record company
yeah.
now.
Well, that was my wife's. I said, well, you don't write songs anymore. And I never stopped writing songs. I just have a backlog. So we decided to put a record company together, and I'm the guinea pig. So it's a songwriter's label. So I'm the template and the guinea pig. So we've formed all the thing, done two albums, one live and one studio album. And each writer will have to do that, a live stage album and
wonderful.
Studio album. And so I'm going back to promote it again. We've just found out yesterday we're Record of the Week in one of the big shows and the radio in the UK. So it's just
so
gradually
are you
growing.
Sourcing like new talent, like new young
yes,
songwriters?
That's the idea, yeah. Just to give them a deal that's fair to them, and also not confuse the issue with people who want to be pop stars. It's to have longevity of copyright and quality songs.
So it's all about,
that's what
it's
started
all about the
me.
Songwriting
yeah.
and that's how you made
yeah.
your start.
Yeah, exactly.
So you're giving a bit back
yeah.
to
yeah.
where you got your...
Mm-hmm. That's it. Yeah, and it's just enjoyable because despite all these shows that personally I think demean music, there are a tranche of fantastic young writers out there and there's not an outlet for them. And
of course.
So we've discovered two or three in Scotland alone that we're really interested in, and we're just hoping to make that grow as we go.
It's wonderful. Good on you, Benny.
Thanks.
Now, the company is called?
On Song is the label.
On
yeah.
Song?
Mm-hmm.
And you have an album?
Yes, two albums, one on stage and the new studio album at
will
the edge of the
Will
wave.
We get it here?
Yes.
And
I'll,
it'll be called?
I'll give them to you right now.
Would you?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful. It's going to be called, or it is called?
The album's called At the Edge of the Wave.
At the Edge of the Wave.
The studio album, yeah.
And are you going to be taking us out today with something from that album?
Well, yeah, I actually got a bit of footage of a song I wrote about Ronnie Lane, so if you want to have that, you're very welcome to play it. And it gives you a description of how I got to know Ronnie and what it was like to play in his band, which was wonderful.
I want to thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Annie.
And it's a pleasure to see you. I'm allowed to thank do you. This because I know. Thank you,
thank
Mr.
you.
Benny Gallagher.
Thanks a lot.
With the wind in your hair and the sun in your smile, spring in your step, you traveled in style, rolling down that road, not a care in the world. Traveling man, dream on, dream on. It's the reason you were here and the reason that you're gone. Keep those wheels a-rolling on that old caravan. Traveling man, dream on.
Dream On is about Ronnie Lane. And after seeing a documentary where we were actually up on the hill playing one of his songs, at the very end of the song, there's this moment where there's kids in the farmyard down below. And I realised it was my kids who were like 7 or 8 at the time, who are now in their 40s, and it was just a lovely memory. And seeing the documentary, I saw some things in Ronnie that I wasn't aware of at the time. We were just so busy playing and recording, we never get time to share as much of information as people, you know. So it's really about him and his lifestyle.
It looks about that way, doesn't it? Yeah. That was fun.